Welcome to Online Worship at Hyde Park United Methodist. I'm Michael Doherty, Director of Traditional Music.
And I'm Matt Hotho, the Director of Production and Online Engagement. Our mission at Hyde Park is to make God's love real, teaching people to follow Jesus by loving God and loving all.
Today, we are continuing our series called Life's Highs and Lows. Throughout this series, we will be exploring the landscape imagery in the Psalms, an ancient prayer book in the Bible. And we will be connecting those landscapes with the landscapes of our emotional lives, joys, fears, concerns, goals, aspirations.
In today's message, our senior pastor, McGray DeVega, will explore Psalm 23 and the famous imagery of the Valley of the Shadow of Death. Now is a great time to take out your phone or open another browser tab on your computer and visit hydeparkumc.org/next-steps, where you can register your attendance, submit prayer requests, and learn more about our community.
The musical offering from the choir that opens today's service has an interesting connection to not only the theme of today's service, but all the celestial happenings of this past week. If you are like many of us here at the church, you found yourself outside on Monday, gazing at the heavens or at the ground looking for crescent-shaped shadows. The first piece today contains a text that was written expressly for the tune from Gustav Holst's The Planets, one of the most evocative pieces in music, expressing the beauty and grandeur of creation. The text contains this line, "Whether our tomorrows be filled with good or ill, we'll triumph through our sorrows and rise to bless you still, to marvel at your beauty and glory in your ways, and make a joyful duty our sacrifice of praise." Welcome to worship.
Thank you. Today we continue our worship series called Life's Highs and Lows in our journey through the Psalms by revisiting the most famous one of all, Psalm 23. I bet many of you can recite at least some of it by heart, including the well-known first line, "The Lord is my shepherd." In a moment, we're going to join in prayer, and then we will have this famous psalm read aloud. And as you hear these words, I invite you to type in the chat section the word or phrase that connects with your experience right now. What part of Psalm 23 resonates with your soul? Type that word or phrase in the chat section in a few moments when we hear the 23rd Psalm read, as we join right now in a spirit of prayer.
Let us pray. Like a shepherd tending the flock, you tend to our needs. Be present with those who struggle, suffer, are in pain or sorrow. Guide those who are lost, are filled with worry and fear. Protect those who are in harm's way. Heal those who are ill. Mend those who are broken, as only your love can. God of peace, watch over those who lead us in our various governments and churches. Fill our leaders with wisdom, patience, insight, and mercy. Help them to lead with kindness and strength. God of love, fill our hearts with the knowledge of you that we can turn from the distractions of life and be more like you. May we be agents of your compassion, making your love real in our world. God of blessings, we thank you for all the gifts of life, for your Son, our Savior, our great good shepherd, the one who stands at the gate of all life's challenges and joys, calling out to us in love, naming us beloved. For all this and more, we pray in the name of the great good shepherd, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Listen to the word of God in Psalm 23. This reading comes from the New Revised Standard Version. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. The word of God for the world.
Thanks be to God.
Let's pray together. O God, open our eyes to empathy, curiosity, and humility, that we might be generous and compassionate toward others and ourselves. In Jesus' name, amen. The 23rd Psalm is one of the most iconic scriptures in our Bible. It's one of those passages you recognize simply by reference, like John 3:16, Genesis 1:1, Psalm 23. You know the words just when you hear the reference. It is poetic and artistic and has been referenced in over 50 popular songs from bands like Pink Floyd to U2 to the Grateful Dead. It's also filled with beautiful imagery that connects to the landscapes of our souls. We've all had moments when we have felt as peaceful as green pastures, when our souls have been restored like still waters, or when God has led us along the right paths, or when we have felt the bounty of God's blessing like a full table set before us. These are all beautiful images. In fact, if you do a Google image search of Psalm 23, you'll find countless artists who have painted this psalm, and they all show similar scenes. Tranquil shades of greens and blues, and rolling hills, and a peaceful flock of grazing sheep. We can easily imagine that that's what the psalmist was looking at when he penned this famous psalm. But if there's one landscape in Psalm 23 that most catches our attention, it's the one that seems quite different from all the others. It's the one we would most readily ignore and prefer to skip right past, because it's the image that disrupts the tranquility of this psalm, just as it disrupts the tranquility of our lives. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. This is pure poetry. It is also stark reality. This phrase contains three successive verbal punches to the gut, describing life at its most difficult, the valley of the shadow of death. We remember that throughout the Bible, valleys are places of fear, grief, and desperation. In the book of Numbers, the Israelite spies returned to Moses in the valley of Eshkol, after scouting the promised land, with 10 of the 12 spies reporting with fear that there were giants in the land of Canaan. So, what are the gigantic fears that make you worry about your future or the future of someone you love? Is that your valley today? In 1 Samuel, we see one of the greatest battles in biblical history in the valley of Elah, between a giant Philistine warrior and a scrawny shepherd boy with just a sling and 5 stones. So what are the Goliaths in your life right now? Does that describe your current valley? In Ezekiel, the prophet describes one of the great visions in all the Hebrew Bible, in the valley of dry bones, where decomposed skeletons reassemble into living beings once again. So what are the decaying parts of your life that you are praying might be restored? Does that describe the valley of your soul today? Which brings us back to Psalm 23, where tucked amid all of the tranquil and lush images between the green pastures and the still waters and a dwelling place with God forever, there is this inescapable, unavoidable reality of life, the valley of the shadow of death. We cannot skip past it. We have to pass through it because it is in the middle of this psalm. Literally and literarily, it is right in the middle of this psalm. My friend and terrific preacher James Howell has noted a very important shift in this psalm, if you notice, the way the psalmist refers to God. In the beginning of Psalm 23, the psalmist refers to God in the third person, as if talking about God. The Lord is my shepherd. He makes me lie down. He leads me. He restores my soul. But somewhere along these 6 verses, the psalmist shifts in the way he refers to God from the third person he to the more intimate, more personal second person, you, or thou. It's as if the psalmist has made a conscious decision at some point in this psalm to not just talk about God, but to talk directly to God in a deeper, more personal conversation. You comfort me. You prepare a table. You anoint my head. That's a remarkable shift from viewing God objectively to connecting to God personally. And where do you suppose that shift happens in this psalm? Yep, in verse 4, right in the valley. This points to one of the central truths in this psalm. It is in the valley that we can experience God most closely and most personally. As painful and as inescapable as the valleys of our lives are, they can also be, and they often are, the most transformational moments in our lives. Because that is where we discover a relationship with God who is with us. It's right there in verse 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, thou art with me. Biblical scholar James Lindberg points to another really choice insight. That phrase, thou art with me, is exactly in the center point of this psalm. There are precisely 26 words before this phrase, thou art with me, and 26 words after this phrase, which makes this psalm, in and of itself, a literary valley in which all the tranquil moments of our past, the green pastures at the beginning of the psalm, and all the hopeful dreams of our future, eternal dwelling place at the end of the psalm, they all converge in the center of the psalm, in the crucible of our darkest valleys. The psalmist would remind us that only when we go through those painful moments can we experience the one truth that will enable us to experience both tranquility and hope. Thou art with me. The early church theologian, St. John of the Cross, went through a valley, and he called it the dark night of the soul. But that is where he experienced God most deeply. Even the incomparable Mother Teresa of Calcutta went through a valley, as she described in her journal, moments of doubt and disbelief. And it is then that she reached out to God to, quote, come be my light. G.K. Chesterton once said, quote, one sees great things from the valley, only small things from the peak. He understood that only when you are in the valley can you see the greatest truths from up close. That's especially true for God. And the psalmist realized that only by being in the valley can we experience the truth that changes everything. This one truth that matters the most, thou art with me. In modern-day Israel-Palestine, today, just east of Jerusalem, there is a wilderness called the Wadi Kelt. Wadi is the Arabic word for valley. Kelt is spelled Q-E-L-T. The Wadi Kelt is one of the most dramatic natural landscapes in the region. It's a deep valley. It's been carved up by a now dried up river for thousands of years. On either side are steep, imposing cliffs dotted with caves and crevices. The valley stretches for about a mile and a half, all filled with rocky terrain. Today, it's a tourist site. Visitors can descend into the valley and see modern conveniences, public restrooms, shady places to rest, even a monastery carved right there into the cliff walls. Still, it takes a few hours to walk the entire 1.5 mile valley. And, by the way, it's one of the few places where both Israelis and Palestinians can enter freely and interact without having to pass through checkpoints. Well, one can easily imagine how threatening and imposing the Wadi Kelt was thousands of years ago. It was a dangerous place to walk, especially alone. There was the constant threat of wild animals lurking behind every corner. The caves were a convenient place for thieves and bandits to hide and pounce on unsuspecting travelers. It is no wonder that the Wadi Kelt is widely known by another name. It is called, the Valley of the Shadow of Death. According to Jewish tradition, this is the place where the psalmist sat and was inspired to write the 23rd Psalm. not on some rolling hill overlooking green pastures and still waters, not a place of tranquility, but a place of danger and fear. For this was the place where the psalmist realized that his entire view of God had shifted, not as one who was distant or absent or largely disconnected from his suffering, but as one who was close by, right there with him in his suffering, whose rod was there to ward off bandits and wolves, whose staff was there to rescue him when he was in danger, right here in the valley of the shadow of death. By the way, there is something else to know about the Wadi Kelt. As dangerous as it was also the fastest route to travel between two historic cities, Jericho and Jerusalem. Jericho, the economic and financial center, and Jerusalem, the religious and cultural center. Imagine the cities of New York City and Washington, D.C., and you can imagine the number of travelers needing to get from one city to the other, and the Wadi Kelt was the fastest route between the two. So there's another story in the Bible told about a man who was traveling between Jericho and Jerusalem, and he was walking the Wadi Kelt when bandits and thieves sprung out from those shadowy caves and robbed him and beat him and left him for dead. He lied there, off to the side, clinging for life in a literal valley of the shadow of his own imminent death. You may realize what story this is by now. It's the one told by Jesus about how this man watched as people passed him by, maybe so consumed by their own fears of being accosted by thieves or consumed by their own busy lives that they just walked right on past him. And as this man was lying there in his suffering, just as you and I struggle through our own dark nights of the soul, we might imagine this man offering these words as a prayer. Thou art with me. Thou art with me. And that's when he felt the outstretched hand of compassion. A Samaritan man, it turns out. A good Samaritan. A man who was, for him, the very presence of God, right there with him in the valley, just when he needed it the most. Friends, valleys in our lives are painful. Some of us may be going through them right now. If you've been through them, you know how scary they can be, but you also know how transformative they are. Because when all seems hopeless and when you feel the most alone, that is when you realize more than ever before, thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Let's pray together. God, you are with us. If that weren't true, then nothing else matters. And because that is true, nothing else matters. In whatever season of life we find ourselves in today, whether it be tranquility or despair, peace or anxiety, you are with us. So grant us evidence today of your rod and your staff. Lead us as sheep in need of a shepherd. And remind us that surely, surely, goodness and mercy follow us as we follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus said, the sheep know the shepherd by his voice. And in response to this word of comfort today, we lean in to hear Jesus calling us to follow him. And one of the ways we do that is through our obedient generosity, in part through our financial gifts. So we invite you to give now directly through our website. If you open a new tab on your browser and go to hydeparkumc.org/next-steps, or you can access it through the QR code on the screen. You can also drop a check off in the mail or at the office on our Hyde Park campus. You know, your gifts really do make a profound difference in the way we're able to do ministry. including through the stewardship of our buildings and facilities in which ministry happens. For many years, our trustees have had on their radar the necessity of replacing the air conditioning units right here in our sanctuary. These air conditioning units, which have been around since the renovation of this place over 20 years ago. We've always known that this was a big, big ticket item, at least six figures or more. But this past month, we were able to replace the sanctuary air conditioning because of your generosity, which led to the excess of income over expenses over the past few years. In other words, we have new air conditioning here in this space without incurring a single drop of additional debt, all because of you. This is no small thing living here in Florida. So watch this video in gratitude to God and to all of you.
Hello. I'm Will Keller, lay leader of the Generosity Committee. Over the past couple of months, crews have been working on our sanctuary towers, replacing the AC units on top. Such a large project could not have been done without your generous support. Your faithfulness and stewardship have not only kept our church thriving, but have allowed us to embark on crucial maintenance projects without the burden of debt. As we journey forward together, let us continue to walk in faith, knowing that our collective efforts will sustain and uplift our campus and community. Thank you for your generosity, your faith, and your unwavering commitment to our church.
When the best of me is barely breathing, when I'm not somebody I believe in, hold on to me.
When I miss the light the night has stolen, when I'm slamming all the doors you've opened,
hold on to me. Hold on to me. Hold on to me when it's too dark to see you, when I am sure I have reached the end. Hold on to me when I forget I need you, when I
Thanks for joining us for worship. There are two great opportunities for you to connect deeper into community this week. The first is through neighborhood tables. Neighborhood tables are a chance to connect across neighborhoods with other people from Hyde Park United Methodist. We'll gather with food and have some conversations, And to help create these opportunities in April, we're looking for hosts to register now. And now that we have a pretty good number of hosts, we've actually opened up registration for participants to join. And you can learn more at our Next Steps page to join one of our neighborhood tables.
And the second opportunity is our new member class, which starts today, April 14th, both in person and online. If you have been attending for a while and want to learn more about our mission, vision, and values, the new member class is a great way to do that. More information is at our Next Steps page.
And finally, we have a special announcement from Mary Britton and Gary Heckman, our lay leaders. Check it out.
We are here with you to share some really great news about our staff, and particularly our clergy. In the United Methodist Church, pastors are appointed to churches by a team led by Bishop Tom Berlin.
Across Florida today, it is Announcement Sunday, where churches are sharing news of any changes in their clergy assignments. And I'm happy to report that this year, the bishop and his team have reappointed all three of our clergy to serve another year.
We are so grateful for the ministry of McGray de Vega, Sally Campbell Evans, and Justin LaRosa.
Let's show our appreciation to God for this wonderful clergy team.
We're grateful to Bishop Berlin and the appointive cabinet for their hard work this entire year in making appointments for not just our church, but churches all throughout our connection. And we are definitely grateful for our three amazing clergy.
Now receive this benediction based on Psalm 23. Go in peace and love and care for one another in the name of the Lord. And may God lead you to places of rest and renewal. May Christ Jesus give you life in abundance, and may the Holy Spirit fill your hearts with gladness and generosity, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen. We'll see you next week.